Right.
Yeah. Okay, so now let's talk about your most recent book, Seeing Jesus from the East, which you co-wrote with Ravi Zacharias. First of all, Abdu, what is this book about, and why should Westerners care how Easterners see Jesus?
Yeah, so this book is, the title says a lot about it, is this recapturing the Easternness of Jesus. And the reason why Westerners should care, and frankly why everyone should care, but one reason why Westerners should care about how Easterners see Jesus is that there is this narrative stream, as it were, that says that Jesus is the icon of white imperialistic, colonialistic, baptized dominance.
Yeah.
You know, that somehow once Constantine became emperor of Rome, and once he got converted, that Rome became a Christian nation or a Christian empire, and that was used to dominate Africans, and that led to the colonialization that happened in Europe and all these things. The reality is that all the bad of the Roman Empire was influenced for the good by the Christian faith. And we tend to forget that. We think of Jesus as this white icon of imperialistic Western religion, when the reality is that olive oil drips from every page of the New Testament and from the Old, that the curries and the spices and the cumins of the conversations and what's going on is so prevalent in the Bible that we can recapture the authenticity that Jesus is, in fact, not an icon of white religion, but he is a universal icon for faith. So there's an Easternness to him that goes against the stream. But the other reason is that in order to understand some of the puzzling things Jesus seems to say, or the seemingly puzzling things he says, is that if you understand the Eastern context in which he actually moved and breathed and acted and ministered, you'll gain a richer understanding of the most influential figure in all of history. So I think that that's super important for us as Westerners to see. And the flip side of this is that Jesus not only believed in the importance of the collective, being from an honor-shame culture, but he never valued the collective over the individual's dignity. And so he would buck tradition when it meant he would vouchsafe the dignity of the individual, which is a very Western thing to do. So Easterners and Westerners alike can see something in the person of Jesus.
You say that in the West, familiarity and complacency have diluted the gospel's Eastern tang. You know, I have found in my own study that as I challenge my assumption of what a given text says, if I'm going to teach a Bible study or preach a sermon, and I go back and look at how the words were used in that ancient first century Middle Eastern context, wow, things end up opening up for me in ways that I've never seen after 30 years of study. And I like what you say there, that familiarity and complacency have diluted the message for us. Talk about that a little bit.
I think that that's true. It's so funny because let me give you two quick examples of where we can get so much depth of meaning and even respond to an objection if we understand Jesus in his Eastern context. So people have said oftentimes that Jesus isn't so much a liberator of women. He's a bit of a sexist or a bit of a bigot. They take the Canaanite woman who approaches him and asks Jesus to heal her daughter. And Jesus says something like, it's not right for the meat meant for the children to be given for the dogs. In other words, we're Jews and we're superior and you shouldn't have this as a Canaanite woman. And it seems so bigoted and so sexist. And she sort of puts him in his place. She says, but even the scraps on the table, the dogs eat those. Now, this is interesting because if you understand the way Middle Easterners actually speak then and today, you'd recognize this is not sexist nor bigoted in the slightest bit. Jesus is doing a common Middle Eastern thing in that he's engaging in the kind of banter that would stick in the minds, not only of the woman who he's speaking to, but of the crowd he's doing this in front of. Recall that his disciples don't like Canaanites either. They were the people who oppressed Israel after they were freed from Egypt, as it were. And certainly not a woman. Don't talk to the rabbi, you know, that kind of thing. They want to shoo her away. So the very fact that Jesus even engages with her in the first place is already evidence of his lack of misogyny and his lack of bigotry. But two, he engages in the banter. He says what the crowd expects him to say, which is, you're the dogs, we're the masters. And then he uses her to turn it around because he then says about her, not so great of faith have I found in all of Israel kind of a thing. He elevates the faith of a Canaanite non-Jewish woman above the faith of the bigots within his own ranks. And so rather than this being an example of Jesus's bigotry towards women and towards different ethnicities, This is actually evidence that Jesus isn't a bigot, and he wants to teach the crowd around him to not be this way. If you understand the way Middle Easterners use banter to prove a point, you'll see the depth of that.